Hey everybody, it's Tony Trombo. Today's show is brought to you by Audible.com. Now you can get a free audiobook. That is a free audiobook download and a 30-day free trial at audibletrial.com/Tony Trombo. They have over 150,000 titles to choose from for your iPhone, Android, Kindle, or MP3 player. That's audibletrial.com/Tony Trombo.
Hi, this is Candy Zappa. I'm Frank Zappa's little sister.
Hi, this is Bob Harris, former Frank Zappa band member.
Hi, folks. This is Robert Bobby Martin from Frank Zappa's band, 81 through 88.
Hi, grown-up boys and girls. I'm Sandro Oliva, and I was the Italian of the group with the Grandmothers in the 90s.
Hi, this is Arthur Barrow, a.k.a. the Clone Meister for the Frank Zappa Band, as well as his bass player.
Hey, this is Lisa Popeil.
Hi, this is Susanna Harris, former vocalist for Frank Zappa.
This is Billy Hulting from Zappa Plays Zappa.
This is Ike Willis, and we're talking Zappa on Uncle Tony's station here. Please, everybody listen. I had a great time, and so will you.
Hi, boys and girls. This is Don Preston. You're listening to Talking Zappa, and you should all listen to this show because it's fantastic.
And if you don't listen to this show, Don will come and get you. Don knows where you live, and he doesn't fool around. What am I saying? I don't even know. It's Talking Zappa with Tony Trombo. That's me. How's everybody doing today, tonight, tomorrow, whenever it is you're listening to this fine program that is now up on YouTube? If I had a sound effects button here, I would hit hooray or applause or something. But as we all know, it's got to be a place. You know, I've tried different platforms to put my Talking Zappa and other shows like this up. And it's easy to get them lost, and people don't listen to them or whatever, and everybody uses YouTube, and so it just came down to, I'm going to stick them all up here. So I'm kind of re-editing and just listening to them. The cool part is I'm re-listening to all these interviews and just relearning stuff that I had forgotten. It's just amazing. Today, this is part two with Pauline Butcher Bird. Pauline, you know, work with Frank in the 60s, and she's got so much to say, and she's got her book out and all this. It's just, I had to do a couple with her. Very interesting and very nice. When I get over to England, I'm gonna go meet her, say hi, or maybe she'll come over here. Pauline, if you're listening, get a hold of me if you're coming over. Without further ado, that's my, is that French? I don't know what it is. It's some word. Without further that word, here is part two with Pauline Butcher Bird. Pauline's there. I know you are, Pauline, aren't you?
I am, yeah.
Very good. Yeah, see, the time goes by so fast on this show that I need to do a couple of them at least. Now, last time we spoke, which I called part one, we talked about you and the book and all that stuff, but I knew that you had a lot of good stories and memories and things about the original band, the Mothers, which I didn't get a lot of chance to talk about. And so I figured this time we could just, you know, hear what you remember about those guys and things. And you said a moment you made some notes. What we'll just go. What do you want to talk about?
Well, I was under the impression you wanted to talk about the Mothers.
So, oh yeah.
I was there from 1968 until 1969. Beyond that, but the first Mothers of Invention finished in 1969 in August. But before that, when I first got to Hollywood, there were nine members of the original Mothers of Invention. And they were newly famous and newly getting onto the ladder of the rock and roll world, as it were.
Right.
And they were all very excited and very happy about it. The only person who wasn't happy was Frank Zappa.
Really?
Yeah.
What did he not want, you know, to happen? That something was happening that he didn't like. What was that? Why and why do you think?
Well, I got there in on May the 5th, 1968, which was a Saturday, and Frank arrived on Sunday to the log cabin where we lived, and he spent the first evening putting his records into the cupboards by the fireplace in this enormous living room where he worked. And I helped him to do that. And during this time, we worked in total silence because he always worked in total silence.
Amazing.
And you didn't talk. He was playing blues albums, Booker T and stuff of that kind, 1950s blues albums. And we were listening to those, and those little 45s, he had loads of them, hundreds of them. And then he stopped in the middle of it to talk. And he told me then, on that very first night when I arrived there, that he wanted to leave the Mothers of Invention. And he was unhappy with them. And he didn't like it because they couldn't play the new music he was writing. And at that time, he was writing Hot Rats, and they couldn't play it. So, in other words, Peaches and Regalia and stuff like that.
Right.
And I was astonished because I had seen them play in London the year before at the Albert Hall. And I thought they were fantastic. I mean, they played such a wide range of music like other bands could not possibly do, like doo-wop, jazz, rock and roll, orchestral music, big band stuff. And also mixed in with that was all the satire and comedy, you know, like taking off the Supremes and stuff of that kind.
Yeah.
And it was, superb. And I couldn't believe that he wanted to break them up. And this moan and groan of his went on the whole time I was there. But what happened was that there was a sort of resolution to it. He told them several times that he was going to leave. And several times he changed his mind. And one of these times was after I told Ian Underwood about Frank's moans and groans. This was about a month or so later. And Ian Underwood was furious. He was absolutely livid. And he went back to Frank and said, "You're not the only one that's miserable. You're not the only one that's fed up. We get fed up with your long face and all your moans and groans about us and your sarcastic remarks." And it didn't go down well at all. And he said, "Well, that's it. You know, I'm leaving and done with it." But of course, the Mothers were really devastated. And so what happened was they went the next weekend to San Bernardino and they got together and worked out a solution. And that was that Ian Underwood would rehearse the band every rehearsal, which they did every day. And Frank would be left to come in when they were ready. And he could meantime do his writing and composing.
I see. And, well, talking to, people from his later band, I guess he kept that going. I guess that was the way he worked from then on. See, I didn't realize that. Having somebody, at that point, I didn't know that Ian Underwood was the guy that did the work with the band, for rehearsing. I wonder... I guess that freed Frank up to do what he really wanted to do, more of the writing part, and I can understand that. But that's interesting. I wonder how they came to have Ian Underwood do it instead of somebody else.
Well, excuse me, Ian Underwood was the most trained of all the Mothers. He was classically trained. He could play several instruments. He'd been classically trained to concert pianist level with the piano. And he could sight read, as I mentioned before when I spoke to you, that he could play Frank's music for him when Frank couldn't play it himself at the piano.
Right.
When he'd written it. And Frank was, Ian was the most accomplished, apart from Art Tripp, was also classically trained and could read music, but he did not have the same, he was younger and he didn't have the same command as Ian did.
I see.
And Ian offered to do it anyway.
I see. Were the mothers with Frank Zappa a band? I know that later on it was, you know, Frank Zappa and the mothers, but when they originally started, were they all supposed to be equal in this group, or was it always a Frank Zappa project?
By the time I got there in May 1968, it was Frank Zappa and the mothers
okay.
of invention by then. And I was surprised by it myself. I was very surprised because for the first 4 years, you know, they had struggled, and it had been Jimmy Carr Black with Ray Collins and Roy Estrada and a couple of the early ones that dropped out. And they had been together, but somehow, because they played Frank's music, he sort of took control. And it was his natural personality to take control, even in the jam sessions that took place at the house. He still took control. So I was surprised by it. I mean, even if you look at the album covers, for example, on Absolutely Free, there he is. His face is staring out of that,
right.
not all the group together. And they're at the floor, on the floor at his feet.
Right, right.
You know, I was surprised by that. But they didn't seem to complain. Well, they didn't complain to Frank, but they did complain to me when I first got there. I know Jimmy Carr Black told me that he was cross because when they went to London on their first trip, Frank had told them that none of them were allowed to do interviews.
I see. Well, I mean, I guess I can understand that. You wouldn't want too many people, you know, I mean, there was a bunch of them, and one guy should be the leader, but, you know, I wonder, apparently Frank wasn't too open to having other people input music and things like that into the group. I mean, he was, this is my thing and we're going to do my stuff and that's it. And I don't have a problem with that, of course, but maybe you should have let everybody else know a little better, you know, who is the leader of the group right from the get-go. But
you've spoken to Don Preston. Did he show any resentment about this? I don't think he did.
No, not a bit.
No.
And, you know, I would imagine over this amount of time, though, looking back at what they accomplished and, you know, what they did, it was a big thing, and regardless of how they might have felt personally at the time, it kind of doesn't count anymore. It's, you know, looking at the big picture, that I think probably every band fights a little bit, you know, they don't all agree all the time. So,
well, they were happy while it was going well, but there was this constant pressure on them with Frank. You know, during that early part when we were there, where he wanted to leave. And then he settled down again when Ian did the rehearsals. And then they came to another upheaval later on, which I'll get to. But maybe I should mention the names of the people who were in the band at that time.
Yeah, yeah.
It was Jimmy Carr Black and Art Tripp. They were both drummer and percussionist. Ray Collins was in and out as the singer. Ian Underwood was saxophonist and the leader when Frank was away. He had to teach. They learned their parts, by the way, you know, a few bars at a time. That's how they did it.
Yeah.
That rather than learn the whole thing and stumble through it, they learned so many bars at a time and then got that right, then moved on to the next bars. I find that a rather odd way to learn music, but that's how they did it. Anyway, there was also Roy Estrada, Bunk Gardner, John Preston, and Jim Sherwood, who was known as Motorhead, who did this, all the equipment. He arrived with the equipment on the Thursday after we first got there, and they had their first rehearsal at the log cabin, and that's where they rehearsed every day in the basement.
Now, did they have a They had their record deal and everything, so they knew that what they were going to rehearse was going to be put out on a record and toured and all that. So it was all, they didn't have to worry about things like that.
How do you mean? Sorry,
they were signed to the record label at that time. So they knew they would record and the songs would get put out. Or was this before Freak Out came out?
Oh, no. Freak Out came out 2 years earlier.
Okay, all right.
And then it was absolutely free. And then also We're Only in It for the Money came out. So those three albums were out by the time I got there.
Oh, okay.
They were always complaining because they never had any royalties and they didn't see any money from royalties. So I don't know whether you've heard any of that complaint, but there was always that complaint from the members of the band.
I've heard that complaint from the newer members too. You know, everybody. And again, that's kind of, I know the members of the original band were, it was all being kind of made up. In the later band, they were paid to play, you know, they were just hired musicians to play. But everybody that I've spoke to from those years, like I say, has always had positive things to say. I really want to get into, you know, how that broke up, and you know, at what point did it just go away, and did all those guys get basically fired at one time, or what happened to break that all up?
Well, there had been several times during that period, from that May when I arrived through to the following year, when Frank had said he would break up the band again, but then he changed his mind and they would have a really good concert, and then you know, he would change his mind. But even in an interview in June 1968 with Jerry Hopkins, he told him that his favorite method of doing touring would be to have a different group for every tour he did. He was even talking about it then. But anyway, to jump forward then to when it broke up, this would have been in August 1969, and they were playing in Canada, and the weekend that the Woodstock concert was on in New York, and they were in Canada, and they were grumbling about the fact that they were doing some obscure concert over there.
Right.
But everything was fine. They were happy. They were in good form, they thought. Everything was fine. But when they got back from that concert, went into L.A. at the end of August, Frank phoned them up and said, "I'm breaking up the band. I want to do my own work. I want to do my own writing. I can't afford to pay you. You've had your last paycheck." And they were paid weekly, so that was it. 1 week, you know, that was it. They've just cut off like that. Well, they were devastated, utterly devastated. But anyway, they called a meeting, and the meeting was held at Frank's new house. He was no longer at the log cabin then. He'd moved to a swanky house up in the Woodrow Wilson Drive, and this was another cause of discontent because he was obviously very well off, and he had this beautiful, great, big new limousine outside. He had grand piano. He had the equipment that ever he wanted. He was always buying more and more equipment to do his recording with and so on. But they were still on a salary of $250 a week, I think it was, by August 1969. So they had this meeting, and the mothers came in, and I think they had it in the back of their mind that Frank would change his mind again, because it was about 3 or 4 weeks after he phoned them, about 3 weeks later, they had this meeting. But he told them again that he wanted to do his writing, which at the time he was writing 200 motels. and he wanted to get on with that. And he couldn't afford to pay them while they weren't touring.
Right.
And so that was fair enough. That seemed okay. But they then said, well, what about all the equipment? If we sell all the equipment, we'll have some money, you know, and what's left over in the kitty and all this business to share out, how much have we got? And Herbie showed them the paperwork. And after they'd sold all the equipment, they were in debt. And they owed, not only were they in debt, but they owed it to Frank, and they owed him $10,000.
Oh, boy.
The story has varied between $10,000 and $20,000, but I think it was $10,000. But anyway, they were utterly gobsmacked at this. They said, well, you've got to, Herbie said, well, you've got to find a way to pay Frank back. So not only had he broken up the band, but they were now told they had to pay between the eight of them, $10,000.
Why were they in debt after selling things? Seems like they would have made money. Or they just sold it for so cheap?
They couldn't understand it. They'd been selling out huge concerts in arenas all over the world. They'd been, you know, sold out. They were the headliners and all the concerts. But Herbie said, well, it was all the cost of the equipment. There was 10 of them in the band, 9 of them in the band. There were eight to be paid £250 a week. Then there was all the travel, hotels, all the expenses. And when they added it all up, they were in the negative. So they were utterly, you can imagine. I mean, not only had they lost their livelihood, they were now told they were in debt and they had to pay this money back. Anyway, Frank could see how devastated they were, and he finally said, well, let's forget the 10 grand and call it quits. And they had to accept that.
To go from being somebody who's just, you know, being told, well, you're just somebody I hire, and then to turn it around and go, well, you know, now you owe me a lot of money. It is amazing to me now that everybody, you know, knowing that, everybody speaks really highly of it. But what was that, you know, that was that 40 years ago or something? I mean, you know, time goes by and...
I guess. But they were bitter. I think Bon Gardner is still bitter about it.
Yeah.
You haven't interviewed him,
Not yet. I'm going to. It might be... I would like to hear somebody who's angry. That would be very... that would be interesting to me to get a little of the other side of it because, it really doesn't make any difference now. No. It's all in the past, but...
But you see, Don Preston forgave Frank more or less straight away anyway. I mean, Frank, after the breakup in August 1969, then come the spring of 1970, he needed the Mothers to finish off a film he was making, which was called Uncle Meat. And he had planned to interview each one of them and use it with film he'd taken in Venice, in the woods there. And he was going to put it into this film, which he shot in his house there over a week, and make it into a whole film called Uncle Meat. Mm-hmm. But anyway, so he called them in again for another meeting. So, of course, Jimmy Carr Black said, well, how much are we going to get paid? Because he was always on about how much they were going to get paid.
Right.
And Frank said, no, you're not going to get paid. You just get your expenses paid per diem. And so he said, oh, well, you know, swore at that. So he refused to take part. And all of the Mothers felt the same. They were absolutely livid because Frank seemed to be making all this money and he apparently couldn't afford to pay them to be in his film, which they assumed would make more money for him.
Right.
So they refused. But Don Preston and Ray Collins did agree and they took part in it. It was shot over a week at the house. And I had to rewrite the script. We had to type it up very quickly because it was changed because they weren't all going to be in it after all. So that was the next stage where they... oh, dear, oh, dear, the story of the Mothers of Invention. By that time, he'd hired Ainsley Dunbar, and he was in the film walking around with a vibrator strapped to his belt.
Right.
And all this kind of madness. But anyway, so then the next stage was that Frank needed them again a few months later for his concert of 200 motels, which he'd written over that period of time. He'd now written the orchestral score of 200 motels, and he wanted to hear it played. And he arranged for the LA Philharmonic to play it at the Pauley Pavilion. But the people who were putting on the concert said they didn't think they would draw enough audience just with the Philharmonic, so they wanted the Mothers as well.
Mm.
So Frank tried to get them back again. And, of course, they again refused. But, again, Ray Collins and Don Preston did agree, and Ian Underwood this time, and they played. And he added Jeff Simmons and Ainsley Dunbar and Billy Mundy from the old days.
Wow.
So that was the new version of the Mothers for that concert. But also it was difficult for them to understand because Frank paid $7,000 to copyists to copy out the orchestral score for the orchestra to play it.
Mm-hmm. And didn't pay them anything. Well, you could see where...
Well, I think he paid them for the concert, but they were already so miffed with him,
right.
So fed up. They weren't, agreeable to it.
Right. Now, I know when they made 200 Motels into a movie, there was, Jimmy Carl Black was in it and so forth, so...
Yes, by that time, of course, he got paid for that.
Ah.
Yeah, for the film, they got paid.
Right.
So he was prepared to take part. And, of course, by that time, the new group was with the Mark Bowman and Howard Kalin.
Right.
And it was quite different. Different kettle of fish altogether.
Yeah. Hmm. And a lot of people, a lot of the original fans liked the original band. It didn't care much for the new band. But that's just an opinion. Frank's band changed so many times over the years, anyways. That
yeah. Well, he got a lot of new fans with that band,
right.
The Mark Bowman and Howard Kalin lot, because there were all these songs about sex, and it was all pretty, pretty degenerate in my mind.
Of course, yeah.
It was all that stuff. So when I next saw him when I was in London in 1972, he had the next band, which was the Grand Wazoo.
Right.
And that was totally different again.
Yeah.
He went to the other extreme of just totally orchestral. And that must have tried the audience very hard because there was no comedy routines, no songs about sex, no satire or anything. It was all just driving instrumentals, which were fantastic if you liked that. But if you'd gone to the concert expecting more of Mark Bowman and and Howard stuff, then you would have been disappointed, I think. But then again, he went on again and did more changes, as you say, after that.
Well, I have about 2 minutes left. When was the last time that you actually saw Frank?
I saw him in 1988 during his very final tour.
Hmm.
And I interviewed him actually for a radio station, but they wouldn't print it. They wouldn't play it because it was too risque for their audience at that time.
I think you've got it posted on YouTube, which I've seen.
Yeah, that's right. I put pictures to it. Yes, that's right. He was in good form, and it was lovely to see him again, and we rekindled our relationship and the way we used to work. It was very nice. But I did
90 seconds.
Okay. I didn't know that within 4 years he would be dead, and that, but he did look very unwell, I thought.
At that time, yeah.
Yeah. Hmm. But I didn't realize how seriously, of course, no one would have done.
Sure, yeah, of course.
And one thinks maybe that's why he completed that. But you ought to talk to Ian, I mean, to Andrew Greenaway, who did the book on that last tour.
60 seconds.
I planned on it. I've got his name. My list of names that I have to, the people I need to get a hold of. I'm making a note here. I always make notes as I go. Well, you know what, Pauline? This is the stuff that I really love. Very few people in the world, besides yourself, really have all this information. I mean, you were right there. Your book's great, and that Freak Out, My Life with Frank Zappa, I suggest everybody go out and get it, because, you know, if you like this type of information, that's where you're going to get it, and really nowhere else. I mean, it's fantastic. You know, I say fantastic a lot, don't I? I say it a lot. I say everything to me is just fantastic. But you know what? That was fantastic. It was fantastic to speak with Pauline again. Got to do it again. Hey, subscribe to my YouTube channel, will you, so you can hear all these over and over and over and over. And friend me on Facebook if you want to contact me. Give me a suggestion on who you want me to interview. I'll do that for you. And that's it for another edition of Talking Zappa. Hey, everybody, it's Tony Trombo. Today's show is brought to you by Audible.com. Now, you can get a free audiobook. That is a free audiobook download and a 30-day free trial at audibletrial.com/Tony Trombo. They have over 150,000 titles to choose from for your iPhone, Android, Kindle, or MP3 player. That's audibletrial.com/Tony Trombo.
Good night, Austin, Texas, wherever you are.